Hey, Lucas here and welcome on knews.space. Today, my top 5 rocket launches in December 2019 that you should know about, not including fireworks. And of course, a belated Happy New Year. December had some falcons, electrons, a lot of China, some hops and even anomalies. Let's check it out, now on knews. In chronological order, first up was a SpaceX Falcon 9 with an unmanned Dragon capsule up top. It was carrying supplies, hardware and some CubeSats to the International Space Station. Most of these CubeSats were launched for NASA's ILANA mission, which stands for Educational Launch of Nanosatellites. Students get to design and work on these, which then end up to get launched to space. How this works is universities build these and NASA selects a few of them. I'm not entirely sure how this selection process works, so if you happen to know, let us know in the comments. What I do know is this mission goes beyond borders because Aztec Set-1, for example, launched in cooperation with a Mexican university and their Kerbal Space Agency. Just kidding, they have a real space agency too. Fun fact, KSP and their space agency spawned at roughly the same time in 2010. That makes me wonder if that has been an inspiration for the game as well? Could be, but you'll have to ask their former lead developer Felipe, who now works on a different game called Balsa Model Flight Simulator that will launch into early access this year. Up next was an Electron rocket that launched off New Zealand. It carried multiple secondary payloads along the main one, which is an artificial meteor shower. Yep, the satellite carries some kind of marbles that it can shoot out of a barrel. Done right, these marbles will re-enter and cause a small artificial meteor shower above the desired region. Seems a bit like a waste of resources, but I personally don't judge anyone to launch fun payloads. In the end, playing video games and watching videos on a global scale consumes a lot of energy too and is not really productive either. I think a world that is just serious would also be very boring. Besides that, the money spent on these meteor showers, of course, stays on ground and is used to develop space hardware and pay for the engineers. One downside I don't want to forget is, of course, the possible light pollution at night. However, one could argue that artificial meteor showers are also fun to watch, like stars, and could get more people excited about space. So I'm quite neutral on that. Launching on the same day was a Soyuz 2.1A carrying Russia's famous Progress spacecraft. It's the cargo version of their crew vehicle, also named Soyuz. Like Dragon, it was filled with supplies, hardware and experiments for the ISS. According to Roscosmos via russiaspaceweb.com, it also carried new parts for the ISS treadmill. That's important because regular workout is key for a healthy crew in space and I think we all know how badly that is needed just after the holidays. Even sitting on the couch here on Earth, your body has to constantly work to pump that blood against gravity from your feet all the way back up. Not so in weightlessness. Your heart and other parts get a bit lazy, so to speak, and returning back to Earth, which is quite sudden, could lead to all sorts of problems. Especially for untrained people that may visit space as tourists in the future. An astronaut's heart is usually super fit when they go to space, which can act like a little buffer. However, the topic is way more complex and I don't want to oversimplify it, since a too powerful heart can also lead to brain damage by bursting blood vessels from overpressure in space. Space is hard, not only when it comes to rocket hardware. What is also hard is to launch two rockets on the same day, which China did. Two Guizhou 1A rockets, which I count as one because I covered them in one animation. This ICBM type rocket launches for the Chinese company called X-Space. Up top of these were multiple payloads that went into a sun-synchronous polar orbit. Five are for Earth observation, meaning small telescopes, and two others are part of a communication system that is called Apocalypse Constellation. The Chinese and their English names. What the name actually refers to are emergencies where their constellation can assist ground crews with important communication links. Especially in the forest or very unpopulated areas where it can otherwise be hard to get a good signal. It could maybe even benefit Tibet, but that's just a guess. Before I come to the last entry for December, let me give a quick honorable mention to Blue Origin. Yup, Jeff was at it again with a new Shepard. The rocket did a suborbital hop as usual and peaked just above the Kármán line at 104 kilometers. On board were zero-g experiments and no crew this time. This may change for the next flight, which is coming up in 2020, but I'm not sure if they squeeze more scientific launches in between or not. Many people think New Shepard is a joke compared to a Falcon, but you have to keep in mind it runs on hydrogen and the engine is actually more efficient than SpaceX ones, both Merlin and Raptor. Their orbital rocket New Glenn will use a modified New Shepard as upper stage, so I find it unfair to say that New Shepard does not belong to an orbital rocket and is therefore inferior. Blue Origin just decided to develop the upper stage first and establish a suborbital business with it. It's basically their small starship. Anyways, I'm not here to promote Blue Origin, I'm just confused by the hate against them. And speaking of hate, oof, the last rank on my top 5 for you is of course the Atlas V rocket that carried Boeing's beloved Starliner spaceship to space for the first time. While Atlas V performed like a workhorse would nominally, Boeing Starliner had another setback within just a couple weeks. The first one was an anomaly with a parachute system on a launch abort test on ground back in November. Only two of three parachutes deployed, which I agree is kinda bad, but you have to keep in mind that this is only one of many, many things that can go wrong. So, talking about what went wrong, it is unfair not to mention that a lot went right. So, the failure that occurred recently was in orbit, shortly after Atlas V released the capsule. You have to know that even modern rockets are not controlled by some kind of AI that would understand what's going on. It's much simpler and probably more robust. There is simply some kind of timer that starts one pre-programmed routine after another. Like, for example, rotating the spacecraft into a particular direction, then firing the engines, deploying the solar panels, rotating to the sun, and so on. An AI would figure, I need energy, I'm in vacuum, I better deploy those silicon panels. Starliner's timer, on the other hand, was off relative to the actual mission time, so the events that happened were right, actually, and they were successful in that regard, believe it or not. But since they were not on schedule, the outcome was not expected and therefore wrong. It's like brushing your teeth during lunch. So Starliner essentially wasted a bunch of fuel and NASA decided to abort the planned ISS rendezvous. However, since this was only a test, Starliner was luckily not carrying any essential payload. Unless you consider Christmas candy essential, which I have to admit would be kind of a big deal to me. But yeah, it was not a big deal for the taxpayer. Nothing was lost, just to make that clear. No explosion, no destruction. Had astronauts been on board, they would have all been safe and, to paraphrase the press conference, an astronaut is trained to spot and deal with a situation like that. The mission had not been aborted early with crew on board. So the mission ended a few days sooner than planned, with Starliner deorbiting and landing, which then went all well. All parachutes opened. I know a lot of people make a big deal about how NASA treats Boeing more nicely than SpaceX after an anomaly, but you also just can't ignore that SpaceX failures were a bit more energetic. SpaceX carried a fully loaded Dragon capsule with important ISS hardware that exploded mid-air. Everything was lost. Don't forget about that. Dragon 2 also had an anomaly on ground which made the capsule itself explode. Such a failure has never occurred on a capsule before. I think one should not compare NASA's reaction in these cases. They are different. These are just my two cents on it and please let me know yours. Okay, that shall conclude my part in this video, but there were of course many more rockets that took off in December, and for those who really don't want to miss any of them, here is the rest in quick succession. Please let me know if it's too quick or just fine. Do you prefer to pause anyways? Also, if you like my work, please consider to become a Patreon or member on YouTube, and of course, special thanks to the 16 people who currently do. As always, auf Wiedersehen and thank you for watching.